First, we have Dr. Anjali Sardana. She is presently the assistant professor in the Department of Electronics and Computer Engineering at IIT Roorkee. She's been working in the area of security for the past 8 years. Her current research interests include cybersecurity, information security, and intrusion detection. Welcome, ma'am. Next, we got Dr. Bhooshan Kelkar. He has a professional experience of more than 15 years, and he's been with IBM for more than 10 years in the US and in India. Dr. Bhooshan holds a BTech from IIT Bombay and went on to get a PhD from UK along with a bioinformatics certification from the University of California and a certification in IP law. He's been nominated for the IBM Master Inventor title for 2011. Welcome, sir. Next, we got Kadambari Devarajan. She's a computer scientist by training, and her research involves applying tenets of computer science to visualize and analyze scientific data. She's a data geek who likes to study wildlife and animal behavior and combine her love for fieldwork and ecology with free and open source tools. Welcome. We've got Kalika Bali. She's a researcher in multilingual systems group in Microsoft Research India. Her research interests lie in speech and language technology for education, NLP, speech technology for Indian languages and linguistic resources, and standard for NLP speech. We've also got Supriya Kannery, who works for the Linux Technology Center at IBM. She's got 14 years of industry experience and has expertise on various software emulation and virtualization technologies. She started her career with IBM's emulation software for mainframes and contributed to planning, design, development, and support of the product. Since 2009, she's been working on enabling KVM for IBM Cloud Solutions. Welcome. Yeah. So, first we'll have Dr. Anjali, who will be speaking on the avenues open for undergrads. Our question was, how do undergrad students get the most out of their curriculum, and how do they go beyond their curriculum?
Good afternoon, everybody. So while you are an undergraduate student, as this session says, make your presence felt. And it is only possible to make your presence felt when you go out of curriculum, out of books, reach out and make the people, make the world know that you exist. So first thumb of rule I would say is to follow this line: tell me and I'll forget, show me and I'll remember, but involve me and I'll understand. So unite and integrate, do some projects, do some research, because that makes you visible. Your projects and research gets you out of book and makes you visible, right? So once you are into the research, into the projects, you become more prominent. And of course, you can, if you are an undergraduate student, you have some master's students at your university and college who are working on their dissertation. Go out, find out the latest technology and area they are working on. They might be integrated or associated with some PhD students. So you get real life applications to work on, real life problems to work on. Second, academia, in my lectures, try to have some kind of mini conferences where I integrate my students, give them a paper to read, a research paper to read. Understand, try to figure out what that research paper is doing. How is it solving a particular problem? For example, if I am teaching operating system as a subject, just limiting the knowledge to a book or two on operating systems, I give these students some paper on latest advances in operating system, make them understand that paper, form a team out of students and ask them to present that paper. So for example, for any recent good conference on operating system, pick up 10 papers, have them presented on the lecture, in the lecture class, is a good idea as to getting yourself involved in research. So even if you do not have that faculty support, you just have the teaching support, you can form groups, read papers, exchange knowledge and get to know things out of besides the curriculum. And then teachers can just open the door. It is up to you whether you can enter or not. So the third rule of thumb is go out and participate, because there are so many things happening around you. We have lot many panelists here, distinguished panelists from industry, who would tell you how they try go out and integrate with the universities. But it is also up to you to keep yourself alert, keep your eyes, ears open, go out and participate. Do not underestimate yourself. Sometimes we are held back. Sometimes we feel maybe we would not be able to make much of a difference. Maybe if we participate, we do not get anything out of it. So do not ever underestimate yourself. Very, very important. Just go out, just participate. Don't be held aback by N people who say N different things. It is your internal motivation, and encourage your peers too. So, you know, engineering would teach you how to learn. It may not teach you the exact thing, but it teaches you how to learn. So that evolves, that learning aspect evolves, right? And so that is what I would say, that education is what is retained when you have learned, what was there in the books you have forgotten, but what you were involved in would be retained by you and taken with you, carried with you lifelong. So this is very important. So these are the rule of thumbs that I would like to stress from the academic perspective.
And Dr. Anjali, so how do students who are from a non-IIT or a non-NIT background,
yes,
how do they approach research or innovation?
All right, from the non-academic or non-IIT background, where you do not have reach to faculty, as I said, who are very active researchers, you always have access to some teaching faculty. So maybe here we can see, use your teaching faculty as a resource to find out what is going on latest in technology. Find out from them, learn something from them. If they may not be able to get you actively involved in research, they would by sure know where the technology is in advancing. And then there is lot of e-advertising going on. We have everything on the net. So for example, we have this engineer girl as a very good example that I would like to narrate, where you can post questions. There are n number of women in computing around the world who would be ready to willingly take up your queries, be it technical or non-technical, and answer it. Make use of all the e-resources that you have. So we are not bound physically nowadays. We have the internet, the openness, which you can make use of. And then sometimes we can say that hard work beats the talent when talent doesn't work hard. So what I mean to stress over here is, that put in some efforts if you have an idea. If you have something in mind, put it onto papers, document it, try to validate your ideas, go out and publish it in so many conferences that are around the globe being organized by good organizations. For example, we hear of IEEE, we hear of ACM. These are the brands. They give you the platform to publish your ideas, your novel thoughts, your original thinking. So even if you are not able to make through at the first attempt, you would get, because all the papers that you write, the ideas that you write and document are reviewed by the peers in your area of interest across the globe. So you get good reviews. You can use those reviews to refine and refine and refine your idea till you break the ice. So it all comes from self-motivation. All I would like to say is be self-motivated, look around you, and there are n number of opportunities that would knock your door. So that is all I have to say to answer this.
Thank you. So let's get a little deeper into research. I now invite Dr. Kalika to explain the importance of writing research papers.
Hi, I'm a researcher, so the things that I can talk about are the impact that you can have through research. And I think Anjali very well said that, you know, if you have an idea, you have to share it, right? And one of the best ways to have impact is to have your idea go out there and influence a whole lot of other people. And so, starting from the beginning, what really is research? Why should we be excited about research, and why can research have impact on your field? In a very simple way, it is asking the right question. You have to be curious. You have to sit and think, why is this happening in this way, and why can't it happen in another way, right? Innovation is really about finding this other way to think about the same thing, right? The world really hasn't changed that much. It has, of course, in certain other ways, but you know, it really hasn't changed that much that all of us are faced with a huge lot of new things that that we encounter, and we have to think differently about them. But the innovation lies in thinking about the same things in a different way. Most of the progress depends upon that. And then research is about you know, conducting experiments in a very broad sense. I'm not talking about you sitting there in a chemical lab and mixing chemicals. That might be the way to go if you were chemistry students or chemical engineers, but maybe not so much for computer scientists. But experiments in a more general way, trying out, testing out your ideas, and then collating all that information, evaluating it. Is it right? What I've discovered in data, is it the right way to look at things, or can I look at it in a different way? So that's what research is all about. And once you have that, you're thinking of research in a different way. Why am I stressing like that you should be writing papers? Next slide. Is this the next one? Sorry.
Okay,
yeah. The one after this, sorry. So why should I go about writing papers? Preethi, it's
the next slide. Okay.
Sorry. Maybe the order is a
little... Okay.
So why should I be bothered about writing papers? Because one of the things that really puts off a lot of people about research as a career is, oh my God, now I have to write a lot of papers. I have to read a lot of papers. It's such a pain to write papers. But you know, it's a skill. If you learn, it will serve you all your life, whether or not you go into research. It is the best way to know whether your idea makes any sense, first of all, to yourself. The minute you start writing down your idea, you know where the gaps are. you know, okay, this is the part that I don't know anything about. Maybe I have to go and think again about it or do something about it again. It's the best way to convey what you think or what your solution is to another person. And it's a great skill. And it doesn't matter whether you're going to be writing academic papers all your life, like a lot of people out here are. But it could be that decide to go into a management track. A lot of you were attending the management track sessions there. Maybe you want to be a manager, but at some stage, a manager also has to do writing. It's something that we still haven't gotten away with. And this is a good way to start, how to very concisely, systematically put forward your own views and opinions in a way that the other person can understand and make sense of and be influenced by, right? One thing, because maybe a lot of you will go in for higher studies and a lot of you will write your GREs and TOEFLs and apply to universities abroad. This is a very good way of convincing a professor who's not spent 3 to 4 years seeing your face every day in the class and has no other way to assess your work other than your results, etc., that you're good at something. You know, most I have been on foreign university graduate application admission committees, and there's very little difference between most students. There isn't a lot of differentiating power that we have to choose one over the other. And papers is a very good way of boosting your resume. You can take a look at somebody's paper and say, oh my God, he has an I, or she has an IEEE publication in one of the really top workshops or conferences, and wow, that must be really good. So it's a really good way of boosting your applications and your resumes. Thanks. So you have this wonderful idea and you want to write a paper. Now, how do you really, really go about doing this? So I think Anjali also mentioned this. There are different kinds of papers. You can write about your primary research. At the undergrad level, very few of us get a chance to do primary research. But you could also write position papers. This is my opinion about how this particular area of field is going to develop. A lot of conferences and workshops welcome position papers. You could even write a survey paper where you're actually taking a look at a particular problem or a particular research area and doing a complete survey of what everyone and every thing that has been done in that area for the past 10 years or 15 years or 20 years. It's always about asking the right questions. The one problem that most of us in India have, I think it's changing now in most institutions. We start with, we're used to this, we have to have this long introduction to set the context. The introduction is just the start, is the jumping board. It is just there to give you the feel that, this is why this is important. But if you spend 5 pages just writing about, okay, so first I went to school and then I did my class 10th and then I came to this engineering class 12, went to engineering school and blah, 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 blah. No one's going to be interested in what you have to say. It's also very important to know when you have enough to write a paper. Don't get so excited by your initial results and say, okay, now I have this, I'm going to write it. You have to be very confident to know where to stop and start writing your paper. And a good way to find this out is, of course, by reading papers, but have some faculty guide you or have some senior researcher mentor you on this. There are lots and lots of things out there on how to organize a paper. Just go search writing a research paper on the web and you will get like a whole lot of websites from various universities across the world which will tell you what good writing styles are, what you know, how to organize a paper, how much the content should be, what kind of writing styles, it should be simple, it shouldn't have too many complicated sentences, etc. But yeah, basically that is it. So the two things that I really, really want to stress here is plagiarism, because we come from a slightly wonky system of learning. There are lots of good things about it, but you know, we should also be very aware of the negatives of the system that we are in. And one of them is that we take notes of everything the teacher said. And you know, that is of the primary importance. So therefore, like we mark out things in books, like this is important. We copy each and every word the teacher said. We go back, and when we write our essays or papers or whatever that is that we are supposed to write, we just, you know, copy the whole thing down word to word. And you know, I have talked to a lot of students, and a lot of students say, but you know, that's the best way of saying it. But yes, that's the best way of saying it, maybe. But you're there to make it better, right? You're there to be more inventive and innovative. You're not there to regurgitate whatever somebody else has said before. So this is something that you have to be really aware of. And it is very important to get others to review your paper. Faculty, yes, faculty are also hard pressed for time. They might not have the time to do this, but even your friends can read it. And if you can get your idea across to your classmate, that means you've done a great job, right? You've actually been able to explain to somebody who's exactly at your level how wonderful the work that you're doing is. And then, of course, lots of people here can tell you about the various venues. Your faculty can tell you about the various venues. Almost every important computer science conference in this world has a separate student track, including this one, right? Like there's a separate student track. So for undergraduates and graduates, like in the first year of graduation kind of thing, in post-graduation, can apply to those tracks. Apply to the student tracks, because the bar is not set so high. Everybody is aware that you're learning and it's a student project, you know. The bar would be, the way your papers would be viewed and reviewed would be very different from like somebody who's been working in the field for 15 years. So go there, be visible, talk to people in that area. Presenting papers is a very good way of meeting others who are similarly excited about what you're working on. And that's always a good way to have impact in your community, I think. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. So she had talked about pitfalls of plagiarism. Now, we'd like a more technical view on the whole plagiarism topic. So I invite Dr. Bhooshan. Now, he's an expert in IP, and he'll be talking to us regarding, so what is IP?
Okay, so good afternoon. I know that we have lunch coming up, so I'm going to take only 5 minutes, and there are just two or three points that I want to touch upon. Also want to emphasize that intellectual property is not only for the PhDs and not only for the people who have lots of money. This is a very important thing that you should take with you today. If you don't remember the details of what IPR is or what the types are, it's not that important. What is important is I have seen a lot of undergrad. How many of you are undergrad students? All of you, most of you. So in the fourth year in Pune and in Bangalore, I have been able to interact with students, and they have had good ideas, and I have been able to tell them that these ideas are potentially patentable, and three of them have actually been filed with Indian Patent Office even before they graduated. So what Kalika was talking about, which is very, very important right now, also Anjali, that you must have publications or something like that even before you graduate, and this is all within the ambit of what you are doing today. So I'm not talking about IPR as when you go graduate and when you have a PhD and when you have settled in your career after 10 years. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about today. And I have seen students actually file for patent applications before they graduate in the third year. So there's no reason for you to think that it is beyond you. That's one. The second point, about intellectual property, there are different types, and I will just go through it in no more than 1 minute, because I think most of it is very self-explanatory. One is the publications, which you will see at the bottom left. And I think we have covered that area between Kalika and Anjali, so I'll not go into that. But do think about publications. It is very, very important, both for industry as well as for higher education. If you are thinking about doing MS or getting into industry, if you say that you have a publication, it's very worthwhile. The second is on the patents, which is the protection of an idea. And on, with sharp contrast to that, we have copyrights, which is really the protection of the expression of the idea itself. And maybe some of you, I know you are some, many of you are from Amrita, right? There is a course on intellectual property rights for you in the third or fourth year. Maybe there is an elective. There are some institutes in India which are doing that. So if you have happen to have this course as an elective, do try and take that. The difference between patent and copyright is that patent actually protects the idea itself, whereas copyright is protection of the expression. So Saregama Padanisa are seven swars, right? But Waka Waka or Kolaveri are copyrighted, even though they are based out of seven swars. So you cannot say that Saregama Padanisa, I have a patent for Sa and Re. I cannot do that. But if I compose something out of it, that is copyrightable. Okay? So this is a protection given to you for your mental creation, which is intangible property. Okay? So if you come to such a point where you have a practical idea, then that idea is either copyrightable or patentable, depending on what expression it is taking, whether it is an it is a composition of music or some words you have written, it's a poem that you have written, or it's an idea which can be converted into an algorithm, etc. Okay? The trademark and trade secret is for later game, so I'm not going to touch upon that because we are short on time and there are two other speakers and there's lunch. So I would just invite you to think about certain ideas which you are already taking up in your studies and think about publications and evaluate within your own mind whether it is patentable or not. So I'm going to request to go to the next slide. These are the three areas which you should test on, whether an idea is patentable or not. The first one is the test of usefulness. Whether the idea is useful, most of the times it will pass that test. Otherwise, you wouldn't be working in that area. The second is it has to be novel, which means nobody else should have done it the way you are proposing. And you can do that through Google search. You can do that with MSN search, Yahoo search. There are many tools which are at your disposal. And then there are formal tools, but those tools are for others and formal search agencies to look at. If you do the basic search and talk to people and find out if your idea is new, that also passes the test. And the third one is the non-obvious or unobviousness test. For example, I'm wearing a blue shirt today. If I say that I'm going to wear a red shirt tomorrow, that is useful because it is still a shirt. It is new because the color has changed, but it is not obvious because you can paint it green, you can paint it white, you can paint it any which color you want. Okay, so the unobviousness is an, I just gave a very simple example, a very obvious example of unobviousness. Okay, so in your mind, think about these three parameters. If they pass, if your idea passes that, then you can think about actually going for a patent. And last 2 minutes, I will tell you how to do it. Just as I'm telling you that it is possible for you students in third and fourth year, and I speak with experience that at least three students have done it just last 2 years. So the amount of money that it takes for students to file a patent with Indian Patent System, Indian Patent Office, is 1,200. That is almost like saying, I'm not going to have two pizzas tonight, right? A large pizza, two times that is what you will require as money to file a patent for. 1,200, I think we all can afford it, okay? The thing that you need to do is write the idea in as many legal words as possible. And I know it's a difficult thing. This is where the legal experts come in. intellectual property lawyers make their money, and that can run into 50,000 or 1 lakh rupees for one patent application. But I'm telling you that I have seen students writing their own patent application, and which is at least 80 or 90% as it would have been done by any other lawyer, because the idea is yours. And I will also put some statistics in front of you and then close, because we have two more speakers. For a population of 1.2 billion and counting of our country, there are just 1,500 patent agents, out of which 500 are retired. The remaining 1,700 to 800 are coming from non-technical backgrounds. They are BA LLB or BCom LLB background. So I'm not trying to say that they are not up to it. I'm just trying to say that if you come up with an IT related patent idea, then it is going to be difficult for them to understand. So just think, there are 200 or 300 patent agents who can really, who know the technology and who can also write the legal language, which clearly means that you are also capable of doing it. And at the same time, I will invite you to think about taking the patent agent exam office, patent agent exam, for you to be a patent agent. That's also a career that you can think of, because there is going to be a lot of demand for writing patents who know the people who know technology. So with that, I think I'll just stop here. We'll take questions if you have later on. I covered all the areas for me. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Next, we'll slightly move on to open source. There's been so much buzz about open source, and we wanted to bring about the actual people who are actually working on open source. So now I call upon Dr. Supriya Kannery to talk about the relevance of open source in today's world.
Okay, so I know you people are hungry, but we'll take some time to take a tour of open source. Few minutes, okay? I'm not explaining about myself anyway, because she already explained, right? So let us see what is open source first. Do you see the picture? What is that? Huh? Illuminati. Okay, the picture is about sun, right? And whenever I vision about open source, I always think about this picture, because this is the most openly and freely available source in the world, right? Open source. So, I mean, that's just a picture which we can reflect in our mind. But when you speak about open source is just actually a, rather than a concept, it's a practice, okay? So where we have the sources available, any sources of any product available openly, okay? It may be hardware, software, it can be anything in the world. And one interesting thing to know is, do we know that open source has been there for long, and there's been practicing open source for long, but only the terminology came when internet became very much famous, okay? And for us to think, can you just suggest or find out what is open source practice in cooking? Any thoughts? Any ideas? Huh? Yeah, she is coming near to that. Ingredients means that's a source, right? Recipe, isn't it? So we are using open source actually daily. Where what we are doing, if you are sharing the recipes with somebody else, it's actually the source is openly provided to other people. Isn't it? So open source is there in all walks of life, and I just listed some of the main things here. In medicine, we have pharmaceuticals, we have non-profit organizations who are trying to make drugs for neglected diseases, which what they're trying to do, they're trying to collaborate between government organizations, pharmaceuticals, and then research organizations. So how this helps? This will be helping if the poor and needy also. And it's freely available, right? Later, once they make it, it might be freely, or maybe with less cheap available. I mean, with cheap cost, it will be available, right? So that way, open source is actually affecting all walks of life, starting from medicine, even to cooking, okay? And one thing which I want to put here is the education part, which will be helpful for you people. not only you, all of us also, where MIT has its open courseware available in publicly available. You know what is MIT? I know you people know. So Massachusetts Institute of Technology has its courseware publicly available in the net. And take some time to look through those courseware. It will be helpful for us, isn't it? Plus, and to bring in the power of open source and sharing through internet, I just put Khan's Academy also. You know Salman Khan? Film star Salman Khan, we know. Okay, there's one more Salman Khan from Bangladesh who is trying to help students by publishing the courseware and making educational videos and available in the net. We just Google and find out the Wikipedia, you'll be knowing, seeing about Salman Khan. Okay, not the cinema film actor, go to this Salman Khan for some time. Okay, so that's about open source. We got an idea about open source. Now we will move to open source software. Okay, open source can be in any area, but we'll focus on software for some time. Okay, so here again I added one picture, we'll come to that later. I'm very interested about this picture also. So free and open source software. So software that is freely available, plus the source is also available for us, that is FOSS. Okay, so how many of you people already have started working on any of the open source softwares? Anything is fine. Yeah, let the hand feel it. No? Okay, so I think it's high time. Because it's very useful for us. It brings a lot of benefits, I'll just discuss it later. But right now, what I'm trying to point out is there are a lot of open source software available, which I'm just put some of the world-changing softwares, what impact it makes on the world. See some of them, Linux operating system, of course, I'm passionate about that, I work on Linux. Then Apache, HTTP server, Android, Perl. All of them are actually world-changing. If you just Google and find out what are these things, you'll find out what impact they are making in the in the world, right? So, how that impact is made? Can anybody suggest how that impact is made? How is FOSS making that impact in the world? Okay, so there comes my picture. Little drops of water make what? Make the mighty ocean. So our world-changing software has come from where? Drops of water. Which is the drop of water? Your contributions. Okay? When you get into software, you are trying to find out what I can contribute here and then start doing it. It starts with little drops only. That's enough. What happens is that the collaboration makes it much bigger. People will absorb that. Make changes to that to their own environment, and then put it back. You again get it. You again make changes to what you want, put it back, and finally it will become a software that's useful for human beings, useful for people. Got me? So that's what I want to project on free open open source and what our contribution can be. So we can go to the next. I'm speaking so much about open source software. I should explain what I'll be doing also, right? So I've been working with Linux for this is 6th year in with Linux, and I work on hypervisor, that's a virtualization software. You know about hypervisor? Okay, I'll explain to you. So what is hypervisor? It is just a software that helps one operating system to run multiple other operating systems. So in Linux, I work on KVM, kernel-based virtual machine, which helps Linux to run other operating systems on that. Okay, so maybe it's a Red Hat operating system, whatever. I mean, Windows or whatever other operating systems you get, you can run multiple operating systems, single Linux kernel, okay? So that's what I'm working on. But I should bring you people to what I enjoy there, right? So why open source is passionate, I mean, I'm passionate about open source is that I enjoy a lot of things which is specific about open source. One thing is, I'm working with a worldwide team. Anywhere else we can find such a team? You've been in academics, been research, been company. You will working on with the people around you, right? But when you work on open source, you are working with a worldwide team. Your team members are sitting where? Not next to you. Different geographical regions. And they have their own culture, right? They have their own passions, they have their own interests. That all will be shared I mean, that will be reflected in the sharing that happens. And that actually help us to imbibe a lot of knowledge about, you know, how we accommodate to people, right? How we adjust to people. So I enjoy that, collaborating with the worldwide team. And then, of course, we all enjoy freedom. I have the freedom to choose my technology, right? So you people, I actually have that. You can go to internet and find out what technology you like, what is the software available there in open source, get in and start working. So you can work on what you're passionate about, right? Then, of course, I love little fighting. You love fighting, right? With your brothers and sisters, or you fight, right? Like that, we can fight with people around us. So, I mean, it's not like physical fight. What I'm telling is, no, we have to stand for our ideas, right? So it's not easy to convince people in the open source about our ideas. So little fighting, little strength we need, muscle confidence we need, and that automatically will come because we want to stand up with our ideas, right? And then we will be working with experts. We love working with experts, no? So whenever we have doubts, where we go? We go to experts near to us, right? To our teachers and to our parents or whoever knows about that. Like this, we can work with experts. Okay, taking dip, that's fine. So now, how is this going to benefit us? I mean, not only us means including us students as well as me and the people who are working on that. Our takeaways, major takeaways are, one is visibility. Okay, I think most of our panelists talked about visibility, you know, projecting our ideas and etc. Right? So working on open source brings us visibility worldwide. Okay, when for example, if you know somebody, somebody's working on a particular open software, you just go ahead and Google. You will find out what she is working on, which are the discussions happening, what is her passion, all those you can find out. Same thing about you. If you want to be visible worldwide, or also his resume, you consider resume, you just tell, okay, what have you worked on? If your interviewer tells, Google my name and you find out. You can find these things I worked on. Right? That's the visibility part you can bring in. And then perseverance. I mean, ladies, of course, we have that a lot. But that will increase. Okay? Because it's not easy to make things accepted. So we have to, you know, follow up with that. Maybe make changes, what other people suggest. And then again, follow up. It will take some time. We need to have some stamina behind it to get that accepted. Then, of course, the confidence to speak up. Okay, we need to be up to date about the area that we are working. Because if we are working on version X, and we talk about version X minus 1 to them, to the community, nobody will listen to you, right? So we have to be up to date. So we'll be competent enough to do that. And of course, the technical and soft skill competence, we will get it. That's our takeaway, okay? So these are some of the takeaways that I've listed here, which I thought is important to share with us. And then I modified a little Star Wars logo there, and what's that slogan there? May the Force be with you. You know Star Wars? May the Force be with you is that. I just made a little change. Okay, so in your journey, as a student, as a corporate or whatever, whatever form you are taking on later, all the best, and may the Force be with you. Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Supriya. Next, we've got Kadambari. She's working in a very diverse field, and she'll be able to explain FOSS and ecology. She's working on both of them, so yeah.
Hello. So I'm actually a computer scientist, but I wanted to talk about the interdisciplinary nature of research that's happening these days, and also talk about FOSS in detail, sort of elaborate on what Supriya spoke about. Computer science, like most other aspects of life, can be classified broadly into the black and white theory and applied areas. But there's also a really large gray middle ground that most of computing falls into. And you take any area of engineering or science, be it physics, be it life sciences, you'll find people using computing for some, if not most, of their needs. And I thought I'll start with an introduction about myself and the kind of work I do and the kind of computing that I do, and then sort of progress into free and open source software. So that's a picture of me. I'm sorry, but I couldn't find a better photograph to sum the kind of work I do. I work with wildlife data, and I do a lot of analysis and visualization. I particularly chose this picture because the t-shirt I'm wearing is a scientific computing with Python t-shirt that I'm wearing, and it just so happens that I'm holding a snake there. And so this is an example of the kind of research I do. Here I was working with the biologist from Princeton who had collected data on weaver birds in Kenya. So it's like I was collaborating with people in the US who were actually working in Kenya. So it's like to give an overview of when things get interdisciplinary, that you'll be working with people from all over the world, you'll be exposed to a lot of cultural ideas and ideas. There'll be a lot of collaboration happening. And here I had come up with the visualization from actual data. This was done using a 3D visualization toolkit called Mayavi, which is essentially a Python library. So I use FOSS for all my research, all my work, my everyday computing, my everything, basically. So this is just a comic from PhD Comics to explain to you that it's world is just interdisciplinary. There's no escaping that. And it's interdisciplinary madness. When I was a graduate student in the US, it was like this. I was working in a lab, but I was paid by someone else. And my advisor was in two different, I had advisors in two different departments. But my actual advisor was in another department, and so on. So that's just a rough, funny but accurate summary of interdisciplinary work. And when there's so many different things, and it would be very difficult to find one tool that would help you. That when you're looking at so many different kinds of data, when you're looking at different kinds of research, so this is where free and open source software, or this is one area where free and open source software can help. So it's essentially a community-driven development. It's you and me just working day in and day out, like how Supriya mentioned that little drops of water, it's contributions, small contributions. And in most places, people are warned against low-hanging fruit. But here, it's the low-hanging fruit and the success and satisfaction of achieving those small targets that essentially drive you. And there are a diversity of projects. There are literally thousands of projects that, and you can pick any to use. There are many ways for you to contribute. There are many ways for you to participate. And the first step of participation is by using free and open source software. So some of the projects are the different Unix-based systems. There's Ubuntu, there's Debian, there's Fedora. And if you're a programmer, or even otherwise, I know many of you would have had to save files, and you'll typically, you would have, as you progress, it will be file name one, file name two, and that's just sheer craziness. It's, you have 100 files, all of them numbered this way. There's no workflow there. So version control systems help with that. There's Git, there's SVN, SVN is Subversion, there's HG or Mercurial. There are a number of version control systems that help make life easier. And for all your web needs, you have content management systems like Drupal, WordPress, a whole bunch of them. And you have, it's just to explain the way that free and open source software is pervasive in every aspect of life. You can use it for arts and graphics. GIMP is a really good art kit. There's Tux Paint, there's Blender. And FOSS is like an absolute must, at least for me, for scientific research. There are just some written there, and most of them, as you might have noticed, might be Python related or in R, which is a statistical computing package, a library, more a programming language than anything else. But there are also Perl, there's PHP, there are a bunch of programming languages that you can use. And the very fact that open source software has a high degree of scalability, usability and adaptability, you would be using, knowing it or without your knowledge, you might be using free and open source software. There's Mozilla, there's OpenOffice, there's MySQL. These days there's no escaping FOSS. So, and here are some reasons why you should be using FOSS. It just makes world domination easier. You can conquer anything if you use FOSS. It's very simple to use. It makes life simple, and it is a way of life. Again, like Supriya mentioned, it's like eating organic food. And it's not difficult, and it's not just for programmers. There are many ways in which you can participate and contribute to free and open source software and also learn documentation and technical writing. You might be a graphic designer who can work on the logos, or you can do a lot of graphic design work. And education and awareness in virtually anything you can basically use and contribute to FOSS. The essence of free and open source software is the word free. And it's not necessarily just free as in free of cost. It's sometimes it's also that, which is what I mean by free beer. But it's more importantly the freedom that comes with it. The free there stands more for freedom than it being free of cost. And why should women be a part of FOSS? Because it's gender neutral and it's a meritocracy. A meritocracy is where if you're good, you can do anything. What you are, anything else about you doesn't matter. It's just how you are, as good as you are. And it's really fun. It's a lot of fun. It's easy to pick up. Once you get in, it's addictive. And you get mentored for free. There'll be different projects, each of them. They'll be trying to get more people in and will be happy to mentor you. Any questions that they have, that you have, they'll be willing to answer. And irrespective of the time of the day, there'll be someone online who'll be willing to help you. And so how do you get started? We've spoken about FOSS in length. There are plenty of mailing lists. You can get on them. It's like learning to write, you need to learn to read. So you just lurk initially, sort of track different mailing lists, and then you can sort of gauge the community before taking the step. And be an active user and be a proactive user. There is a difference. And you have the first step to contribution is actually using. And there are plenty of opportunities. Most of you would have heard of the Google Summer of Code. Some of you might have even tried applying, or might already be GSOCers. There's also the Google Highly Open Programming Contest. There are not just Google, but many other places have a number of opportunities. They offer the grants, fellowships, sponsorships, and just for a small bit of contribution that they expect from you. And read and write documentation. Reading documentation will help you learn the tool that you are trying to use, learn the software. And then once you read, you can submit snippets to the gallery, or you can write documentation, help. There'll be some missing links. There'll be some even just minor grammar edits that you can make. And translations. Since it's a global phenomenon, there'll be people from many countries who are using it, and not everyone knows or uses English every day. So you can translate to regional languages. You can translate existing content to any language that you want. And there are lots of community events happening, so you should just participate in them. And so that's just a small cartoon again from XKCD. Here it's basically just a spoof on how pre and open source software, or Python in this case, can. I just type import anti-gravity. If any of you use programming, you should go into the shell and try typing import anti-gravity on your Python shell. But I do think it's the Python. So thank you.
I'm sure all of you would have got a lot of gyan how to go about, you know, with projects, FOSS, IP during your undergrad. Since we're running a little behind schedule, we'll take questions offline. That's fine with you. Yeah. So I thank all of you for making it today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Preethi, and all the panelists. I think this was a really knowledgeable session for all of us. And there is an announcement for all the students. Please convey it to your friends and other students as well, that we have a technical contest in the afternoon session. That is after the lunch. So please be here at 3 p.m. sharp. Please inform your friends and others as well. And tomorrow again, you have to be here in the Hall A. Okay, and we'll be having whole day, we have differentiations. These has been tailored for you especially. So just gain something from it, get benefited, okay? Thank you so much. Please proceed for the lunch, and you can take the questions offline.